Father, we come to you this morning in the name of Jesus and all that he has done. And Lord, we thank you for the blessing of your Spirit, Lord, and the fact that we can have fellowship with you through your Holy Spirit, that your Holy Spirit is our teacher, our guide, our encourager. And Lord, that by your Spirit you commune with us and fellowship with us. The Father communes and fellowships with us. And Lord, that you have given us something that is so valuable and so incredible. And Lord, we pray that you will help us to go deeper into this relationship with your Holy Spirit so that we may know you and know the Father. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, when I was praying about what to share today, I felt that I must speak on the Holy Spirit. Now, it's going to be a little bit different because I've never heard anybody speak on specifically these things. And so I'm hoping that this is something that will really help people. Now, obviously the Holy Spirit we see right from Genesis all the way through to Revelation. I mean, the Holy Spirit features everywhere, but in different ways. So for example, we see the Spirit of God hovering upon the face of the waters. We see the Old Testament prophets like Samuel, for example, where the Spirit would come upon him and God would speak to Samuel and many of the other prophets in that. And God would actually speak to them and they would then communicate that to whoever, to Israel or to David or to Saul or to whoever, you know. But often it uses this term. It says the Spirit came upon them. Spirit came upon them. And because the Spirit came upon them, they heard. Right? So even when Samson, you know, pushed down the building, the Spirit of God came upon him and he gave him super strength. And so that's what we see constantly in the Old Testament. We see, for example, Elisha. So the Spirit of God would come on Elijah and he would prophesy or speak things and it would happen. Quite incredible, actually, the ministry of Elijah. And then we see Elisha and that whole thing where Elisha wanted a double portion of what was on Elijah. And we see it in symbolically in a mantle. And so you hear people talk about the mantle or the anointing. Those are really Old Testament terms, but it actually explains a lot. You know, a mantle you put on you. So it's an anointing that you put on you. It's and so when Elijah is taken up into heaven, the mantle stays behind. And he grabs the mantle and he puts it on him and he receives a double portion of the Spirit that was on Elijah, which is quite incredible. Now, when you look at the Old Testament prophets, I mean, they did a lot of signs and wonders and healing and all this kind of stuff, but there wasn't healing. They didn't lay hands on people and they got healed. It's interesting. I mean, think of it. God, they would hear from God and give an instruction, go and wash yourself 7 times. You know, it's that kind of thing. We do not see in the Old Testament any of what we see in the New Testament when the Spirit came and what we saw with Jesus. It was very different. Right now, in the Old Testament, the anointing also it featured in a way that is almost unexpected. And by that I mean, you know, as we looked a while ago, like with David and Israel and how God would give them supernatural strength. And, you know, the 12 sons of Jacob that were called the sons of thunder. I mean, where they would go in and wipe out an entire village. And, you know, so there's things in the Old Testament that we just don't comprehend. It's too difficult, like the Nazarenes, you know, like for example, if you take the whole thing with Samson and that they weren't allowed to cut their hair and that, there's very little about that, actually. But there was something in that time period, these people that were that weren't allowed to cut their hair and everything of which he was part, that gave him supernatural strength. Okay, doesn't make any sense. Then we have, for example, Moses, his staff, the staff that was stuck in the ground, which was actually the staff of Noah. So in the Apocrypha writings and all of these other writings and that, you get the whole story of the staff, and which it actually came from Adam. And so you have the staff. So Noah gets off the ark, takes the staff, sticks it into the ground, and nobody can pull it out. And then we get Moses coming along, and Moses then walks up to it and just pulls it out. And so that anointing is passed on to him through the staff. And so so everything that Moses does, the staff features. So, you know, when the guys had their snakes and that, he throws a staff on the ground, it becomes a snake, and it devours the snakes of these other guys. So they had supernatural powers. You see, it's like, it's one of the things about, and I don't want to go off into the thing of the spirit realm and demons and all that kind of stuff. That we'll do a teaching on that at some stage. But the fact of the matter is that these, well, I don't know what you can call it, the guys from Egypt, and that they could do signs and wonders by the gods that they served, and it was real. I mean, their staffs turned into snakes. I mean, so God tells Moses, see, again, that thing of instruction, cast down your staff. He didn't know what was going to happen. He throws down the staff and it devours the other snakes, and they don't have their staff anymore, which is the symbol of their power. So Moses' power devours their power. So now they don't have staffs. You see what I'm saying? Then God tells Moses, when they get to, also with the Red Sea, he tells him, extend your staff over the water, and the water parts. And so we see the staff of Moses playing a major role in everything. Because and where does the staff land up? In the Ark of the Covenant, kept over there. The staff is used to decide who must lead Israel. You know, remember there was Joshua and Aaron, if I remember correctly. And the staff budding. And so the staff that's in the Ark of the Covenant is a budded staff. Now, think of that for a moment. It was a dead stick for centuries. And suddenly it buds to show who the next leader will be of Israel. I mean, that is pretty incredible, I think. And so in the Old Testament, we see the Holy Spirit, we see the anointing, we see the power of God manifested time and time again in various ways, but it's on the few. Israel couldn't hear God. So even with Moses, Moses heard God. Now Moses, the story of Moses is actually quite incredible, and we find that in Exodus 33, 34, and that. And I just want to read some things from Exodus, because, you know, when you, there's things that we miss. Where we go, 33, okay. Don't want to lose my place over there. So Exodus 33 verse 10. Now listen to this. Now, this is the part where, remember, Moses had been up onto the mountain and all this kind of stuff, and Moses asked to see the glory of God. He receives the tablets, destroys the tablets because he's so cross with Israel. Has to go back up onto the mountain. God gives him the Ten Commandments again, comes back down. The Levites have to put on their swords and destroy the people, because with the law came immediate consequence. You see, up until that point, Israel was not living under the law. So God brings them out of Egypt under grace, under the Abrahamic covenant. But they don't honor the Abrahamic covenant, so God gives them a covenant that will kill them. That's what it says in the New Testament in Romans, okay? It says that which was supposed to bring life brought death. And so this covenant, this Mosaic covenant, brings immediate death into the camp of Israel and repeatedly after that. And the role of the priests changes. The priests have to execute judgment on Israel. And then on top of that, there's the judgments that fall, you know, where the ground opens and swallows up people, and oh my goodness, I mean a lot, and a disease that strikes them, and they have to put the serpent on the pole so that people can be healed. A tremendous amount of stuff happened in the wilderness, but everything was where God instructed. God would tell Moses, do this, do this, do this, do this. And so Moses has this incredible a relationship with God, and there's so much that it's difficult to convey everything. It says in chapter 33 of Exodus, listen to this, verse 1, it says, the Lord said to Moses, depart and go up from here, you and the people whom you have brought out of the land of Egypt, to the land which I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying, to your descendants I will give it. And then he says this, he says, I will send my angel before you, and I will drive out the Canaanites, the Amorites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. So he tells him that he'll send the angel ahead of them. And he says, go up to the land flowing with milk and honey, for I will not go up in your midst, lest I consume you on the way, for you are a stiff-necked people. So basically what he's telling is, we hope you get there, because, you know, I might just kill you before you get there. And when the people heard this bad news, they mourned, and no one put on their ornaments. And for the Lord had said to Moses, say to the children of Israel, you're a stiff-necked people. I could come up into your midst at one moment and consume you. Therefore, take off your ornaments that I may know what to do to you. It's quite... And so the children of Israel stripped themselves of their ornaments at Mount Horeb. And Moses took his tent and pitched it outside the camp. Very clever. So Moses decides, okay, you know, if God's judgment falls, I definitely do not want to be in the camp. So he pitches his tent outside, and so he can watch. He pitched his tent outside the camp and called it the Tabernacle of Meeting. This is where I'm going to meet with God. And it came to pass that everyone who sought the Lord went out, okay, to the Tabernacle of Meeting, like I say, which is not the actual tabernacle. And so it was whenever Moses went out to the tabernacle, which was his tent, that all the people rose, and each man stood at his tent door and watched Moses until he had gone into his tabernacle. And it came to pass when Moses entered the tabernacle that the pillar of cloud descended and stood at the door of the tabernacle, and the Lord talked with Moses. So it's a bit different to what we generally believe, okay? And then, and all the people saw the pillar of cloud standing at the tabernacle door, and all the people rose and worshipped, each man in his tent door. And so the Lord spoke to Moses, listen to this, face to face, as a man speaks to his friend. And he would return to the camp, but his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, did not depart from the tabernacle. Then Moses said to the Lord, see, you say to me, bring up the people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. And then we get the whole story of, Aaron went with Moses. And he says, if I found grace in your sight, show me the way that I may know you, and that I may find grace in your sight. Then consider this nation as your people. And then God says this to him. He says, my presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. And so it goes on. And so we have this constant backwards and forwards where God speaks to Moses, and that, and then later on we see this thing where it says that so the glory of God starts to come on Moses at a point. So Moses would go out, he would go to the tent, he would come out, and he would speak to Israel, no problem. But after this, where God spoke to Moses face to face, it changes, and we see that he shone with the glory of God. So much so that the people hid their faces. They couldn't look at him. And so in order for Moses to speak to the people, he puts a veil over his face. And so when he went into the tent, he would remove the veil and God would speak to him face to face. Now think of it for a moment. Imagine God, light, glory, Moses, veil off, light, glory. Picture it. And there's this communion that's happening between them. Unveiled, nothing in between. It goes beyond comprehension, actually, when you think of it. Now, it says, it talks about the old, and it says, if that was so glorious, how much more glorious is not the new? If they experienced that in the Old Testament, imagine what God has for us here in the New Testament, in the time that we live in. Remember, the Spirit would come upon them. They would speak to God. They would have to make atonement. They would have to make all the sacrifices, which obviously pointed to Jesus, right? And then, what happened with this is where, now this is after this. Okay, so Moses meets with God. Initial thing. And then this happens. Moses pleads with God. This is in Exodus 33 verse 18. He pleads with God and he says, please show me your glory. Now imagine, okay, this is before this, where the glory and that. This is where God just meets with Moses, speaks to Moses. He goes out and he speaks to the people. And he says, show me your glory. Then he said, God says this to him. He was begging with God. He says, I will make all my goodness pass before you. And I will proclaim the name of the Lord before you. I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. But you cannot see my face, for no man shall see me and live. And he hides him in the rock. He says, I will put you in the rock, and I will let my glory pass by, and I will cover you with my hand while I pass by. Then I will take away my hand, and you will see my back, but my face you shall not see. Okay, then he tells him to cut the two stones of tablet. That whole thing happens. He comes off the mountain. Nothing's changed. Okay, and the whole thing happens. But remember now, Moses comes off, destroys the tablets, has to go back. This time, first one, Moses chiseled or whatever, the tablets. Second one, God wrote it with his finger. Right? Comes off the mountain and something changed. Because we see a new Moses, we see a different Moses, we see a Moses that is shining with the glory of God, we see a Moses that is, the Bible says that when he was taken, it says his strength was like that of a young man and his eyesight was like that of a young man. Who do we see on the mountain of Configuration? Elijah, who was taken up into heaven, and Moses. That should tell us something. And so it says that God spoke to Moses face to face. There was this, Moses got his wish, but in the process, you see, the flesh dies. And so Moses received a supernatural body. And so some translations say that he was, remember with the promised land, and it says that Moses was, that he died. It doesn't. It says he was taken up to be with his forefathers. He was separated from Israel unto his forefathers. Okay, and they may assume it's dead, so he died. If Moses had not, if God didn't take Moses, Moses would have still been around. And so the two people at the Mountain of Configuration are two people that received their glorified bodies that were taken up into the heavenlies in physical form, Elijah, Moses. The same happened with Enoch. Right? Now that's the old covenant. That's the Old Testament. I mean, one could go on and on and on and on. It's very interesting in Genesis 32, verse 30, it says that Jacob saw God face to face. I mean, remember Jacob built an altar after he had that encounter with God where God gave him the promise. And so he says this, he says, I saw God face to face and he didn't destroy me. But yet Jacob died. Jacob didn't, it's not the same as Moses. He saw this heavenly vision, and for him it was like he saw God face to face, but it wasn't, if I want to put it like that. You know, even Moses' initial encounter with God at the burning bush, in the New Testament it tells us, it says it was the angel of the Lord that met with him at the burning bush. You see, it's not the same as the encounter that he had where it was glorious and it was different, right? And so now we have, so I mean, one could go on forever about the Old Testament and all the things that happened in the Old Testament. I mean, quite incredible things, but a lot of it war, victory after victory after victory. The nations are scared of Israel because they say we cannot contend with their God. Their God is more powerful. And so God demonstrates his power in the Old Testament by the empowering of Israel and victory over the nations. Very interesting. Right? But then we see this personal interaction through the prophets the whole time. But it was the select, the priests, the prophets and that could hear God and had to convey. The people did not hear God for themselves. They were dependent on the prophets. They were dependent on the priests to make sacrifices on their behalf. You see that in the Old Testament, there's this thing where there's God, there's this in between the kings and the priests and even the kings for that matter, right, ruling over the Israel net. So kings, prophets, and priests, and then we have the people. Now in the New Testament, Jesus comes along. He's born as a man, as was promised, as was said, how the Messiah would come, and they somehow missed it. And he grows up as a normal person. There were things about him that were odd. I mean, if you look in the Apocrypha and that, I mean, Jesus would do things that would baffle the other kids and that. I mean, the one time when he went missing and he'd gone to the tabernacle and he was reading from Isaiah about himself, you know, and it says they marveled at his knowledge of the scriptures. And so he was different, right? But he was a man. He's called the Son of Man. But you said to Mary, his name shall be Emmanuel, God, man. So man, a person, El, God. So God as a man is literally what Emmanuel means. But as a man, God becoming a man. Okay, it's like, and so the Holy Spirit, we know the whole story with John. And John baptizes people in the river. He's the voice crying in the wilderness. It calls people, calls Israel to repentance and that. And Jesus comes along and he is the second Elijah. Interesting enough, he's referred to Jesus because in the Old Testament it speaks about Elijah that would come, right? And they asked Jesus about this and Jesus said, it's John. So it's not really Elijah. It's someone like Elijah. But it's interesting, he doesn't do what Elijah does. What's the similarity? Well, calling people to repentance and to return to God, that's a similarity, right? And so Jesus comes along, John speaks about the one whose thong of his sandal he's not worthy to tie, that will be the one. And Jesus comes along. He immediately recognizes Jesus. Now, here's something interesting. John, now, this is a first. It says he was filled with the Spirit from his mother's womb. Game changer. didn't happen in the Old Testament. So here you have a person, it says he leapt in his mother's womb when they met. You remember Mary and Elizabeth? Because he was filled with the Spirit of God from conception. I mean, that is incredible. So he's born, when he's born, he's filled with the Spirit from the word go. And just as he leapt in this, in the mother's womb, when Mary came along and he recognized Jesus, Jesus comes along to him at the river and he recognizes him. He knows this is the Messiah. And he says, Lord, I'm not worthy to baptize you. And Jesus tells him, basically, this has to happen. He baptizes him, which is a baptism unto repentance. Now, Jesus didn't need to repent of anything. And anyhow, Jesus comes up out of the water and he's filled with the Holy Spirit. It speaks about the dove that descended and the voice that spoke, this is my son, in him I'm well pleased. And some other books that say, this is my son, listen to him, and always give heed to him. Jesus comes out of there, and now he's filled with the Spirit. So first we have John filled with the Spirit from conception. Then we have Jesus coming along, being filled with the Spirit, and he's led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted. Now Adam gave up the authority that was given, and it never had been redeemed. It had never been given back. He goes into the wilderness, he's tempted by Satan in the same three temptations that Adam faced. Then, not the same temptations, but the same type of temptations. He speaks about the eye, lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. And he tempts him, and he says, no, no, no. Takes back the authority that was lost. Now he comes out of the wilderness and it says he's filled. It says he went into the wilderness filled with the Spirit, comes out of the wilderness filled with power. And immediately it says rumor went out about him. Now Jesus is, there's a difference. There's something different. He's filled with the Spirit. He's filled with power. He has taken back the authority. He comes out and his ministry begins. But now it's different. The Spirit doesn't come upon him. He is inhabited by the Spirit. And so, which is God, which is Jesus, which is a whole teaching, which is complex, and that is about, because the Jesus was dependent on the Father. In other words, he's the Spirit of Jesus, the personal Spirit, was still dependent on the Father, because he was the Son of God. Okay. But Jesus came to demonstrate something, to basically show what was to come. And he gathers his disciples, he sends his disciples out, and they do the same signs and wonders that what he did. It's like they become like an extension of him. But now remember, they were not filled with the Spirit. They had not received the Holy Spirit. They were operating in the anointing that was on Jesus completely, 100%. And so when you look at the New Testament, it's sort of divided. In other words, you have the pre-Pentecost period and you have the post-Pentecost period. And you have scriptures that apply to the pre-Pentecost period and you have scriptures that apply to the post period. You can see, so it's not the same anointing. It is not. So when you look at the scriptures and the things that the disciples did, yes, it shows what was to come, but it wasn't the same. Their anointing was entirely dependent on the anointing that was on Jesus. Then, after the death of Jesus, the resurrection of Jesus, we overcame death. We took the keys of Hades and overcame Satan on our behalf. Jesus, after 40 days, ascends into heaven. and his ministry is basically complete. But before he ascends into heaven, he says, tarry in Jerusalem. Because you see, the source of their power is now being taken away. So basically what he was saying is, you will no longer be able to heal the sick and cleanse the lepers and raise the dead because I'm going away. So you need to wait in Jerusalem for the promise, for the Holy Spirit that will come so that you can be empowered. But this empowering now is very different. And so they tarry in Jerusalem, 120 disciples in the upper room, and the Holy Spirit descends. And this time it's tongues of fire and wind. That's very interesting. The word spirit, pneuma, means wind or breath. Yeah. And the fire, obviously the power of the Spirit. So the two symbols of what was supposed to happen, the fire of the Spirit, the zeal and everything, and that, and the Spirit being like breath. Jesus spoke of the wind. You don't know where the wind blows. He used that analogy. So it is the Spirit of God. And so they're empowered by the Spirit. And immediately we see signs, wonders, and miracles. Because what did Jesus say? He said, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you to be my witnesses. And then he says, you will be filled with power. Filled. It's different. So it's a coming upon. It uses three terms in the New Testament. Come upon, baptized, filled. Okay, so come upon, baptized, immersed, filled. And now they operate. Jesus said, the same miracles that I did, you will do, and even greater miracles because I go to the Father. And they do. Now, we don't know all the miracles that Jesus did in the Old Testament. We don't know. We just don't. The Bible says that if all the miracles that he had done would be documented, there wouldn't be enough books, you know, to contain it. You know, in those days, they didn't have computers and stuff. So, but he must have done. I mean, imagine, there were thousands of people that were thronging. It says he healed everyone who was sick and oppressed of the devil. In other words, and we see this, and even with the disciples, he uses the term all. They healed all who were sick. And we see this anointing that was so powerful. The disciples, because they're filled with the Spirit, part of that is hearing from God. Remember Jesus said this. He said, when the Spirit comes, he said, basically, even though you don't see me, you will see me because I will be in you. And he said, because the Father and I will come and make our tabernacle inside of you. You will become my tabernacle. Moses goes out, pitches his tent, tabernacle. And God meets with him in the tabernacle, which is the tent. It's actually, the word tabernacle means tent of meeting. That's actually what the word means, tent of meeting. And we become the tent of meeting. We become the tabernacle. The Holy Spirit comes down and comes and indwells us. And the Holy Spirit is the Father. And the Holy Spirit is Jesus. When it comes to teaching on the Trinity, there is so much confusion. When I say some of these things, some people get extremely upset and confused and all that kind of stuff, because when I tell them, I say, in the Old Testament, we see the Spirit, but we don't see anybody communing or talking to the Holy Spirit. They talk to God. It says, by the Spirit, they spoke this and this and this. Okay, we see that over and over. Now, in the New Testament, we see the same thing. So Jesus uses terminology that sort of gives the Spirit a person. And it's almost like a person, in a sense. But some of the words have been added in the Greek, with the translation into the English. Like he and all of that is added. And so one has to look at the totality of the New Testament to see how did this work. Right. So no point do we see anybody praying to the Holy Spirit in the New Testament? Who do they pray to? The Father, Jesus. You see, it's the Charismatics were the guys up until the Charismatic movement. People didn't pray to the Holy Spirit. They prayed to the Father and Jesus. They believed in the infilling of the Holy Spirit. The Pentecostals believed in the infilling of the Holy Spirit and speaking in tongues and so the Charismatic church comes along, and suddenly there's this thing where, you know, the Holy Spirit now becomes somebody that you talk to and commune with and everything. Now, technically, it's not a problem. So what I mean by that is, because the Holy Spirit is the Father and is Jesus, if somebody wants to do that, it's not a problem. But we don't see any evidence in the New Testament of that. Because the Holy Spirit is the Father, and the Holy Spirit is Jesus. And so when the Spirit comes and indwells us, it's the Father and Jesus that comes and tabernacles inside of us. And through the Spirit of the Father, which is also the Spirit of Jesus, we are able to commune and have fellowship and experience Him. Okay? Does it make sense what I'm saying? So, Jesus made this statement about Himself. He said, remember the disciples came and they said, "Show us the Father." And He said, I've been with you for so long and you still don't get it. He said, "He who has seen me has seen the Father." Why? Because the Father and I are one. And then He makes a statement, says, "I am in the Father and the Father is in me." That is the mystery of the Godhead. Because they shared the same Spirit, they are two totally separate entities. That's why they can talk to each other. They're totally separate. Jesus is out of the Father as a Son, a completely separate entity. But the Spirit is one. And so Jesus is in the Father, and the Father is in Jesus. And so when the Holy Spirit, which is the Spirit of the Father and the Spirit of Jesus, comes and fills us, we have the Father and Jesus. That's why Jesus said, "The Father and I will come and make our tabernacle inside of you. You will be the tabernacle. You will be the place of meeting." Now, what's the prerequisite for that? Well, you have to be born again. It has to be a cleansed tabernacle. The Holy Spirit will not come on a not cleansed tabernacle. And so it's when people turn to Christ and that they receive. So when we become Christians, we do not receive the Holy Spirit. It's where a lot of confusion comes in. We receive a newborn human spirit. So when Jesus spoke to Nicodemus, He said to him, "Unless a person dies and is born again of spirit and of water, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." So it's a spiritual death. Our old spirit, so not the soul, not the body, the spirit part of us dies. And out of the Holy Spirit is birthed a new spirit into us. Bless you. So out of the Holy Spirit is birthed a new spirit. And that's why it says our spirits bear witness with God's spirit that we are His children. It says this spirit within inside of us, this newborn spirit, this is not the Holy Spirit. This newborn spirit cries out, "Abba, Father." And bears witness that we are His children. So the word "adopted" has been put in, which is not in the Greek. It says we've received not the spirit of bondage to fear. Now, it's the most ridiculous thing that. And again, I'm sorry, the Charismatics, we charismatic, but the Charismatics come up with funny stuff, okay? And so we have this thing of that fear is the spirit. Based on that scripture, it's talking about the old spirit under the law. It says we have not received the spirit of bondage and fear, but we've received the spirit not of adoption, the spirit of sonship. And then it goes on, Abba Father, this relationship bearing witness that we are his children. Okay, the old spirit lived under fear and bondage because it was under the law. But it says, it speaks about dying to the law so that we can be married to Christ. So that's an important component. So we die to the law to be married to Christ. And so we die spiritually. Our old spirit man dies. And we're severed from the law. So that, and now there's this thing where a new spirit is birthed out of God's spirit, and our spirit cries out, Abba, Father, because we are the descendants, spiritual descendants then of God. That is what it means to become a Christian. You accept Christ, and because you accept Christ, this is what happens internally. And we become Christians. And so we receive a new spirit, not the Holy Spirit. Paul goes out and he says, have you received the Holy Spirit? And they said, no, we've only been baptized with the baptism of John unto repentance. And so they were Christians. A lot of people were at that stage were believers. And the Holy Spirit fell on them just as it did. And so we see this repetition of the Holy Spirit falling on people. So one of the most ridiculous teachings in the churches, and that is this thing that got to do with the infilling of the Holy Spirit. And that is that they use the analogy. One is the analogy of a sponge. And so you take a sponge, you put it in the water, you put it out there, and it runs dry. And so you've got to come back and be filled over and over again. Okay. With no scripture to back it. The other analogy is, you know, where the one with the bottle, you know, that you tip over, and if you take the bottle out, it runs empty. So you got to put it into the water again so it can be filled and all this kind of stuff. And it's all got to do with a tense, a mistake in the translation of the tense. But it is actually correctly things. But in Acts 2, they were filled with the Spirit on the day of Pentecost. They spoke in tongues, they prophesied, all that happened. Then in Acts 4, it says, They had to speak and defend their faith and everything like that, and they were threatened and that by the Pharisees and the Sadducees and all of this. And so it says they prayed, you know, and asked God to confirm the word with signs following, etc., etc. And then it says that, it says those who were filled with the Spirit spoke the word of God with boldness, and God confirmed it. It's in past tense. Those who were filled, those who had been filled. It's not a re-infilling of the Holy Spirit. You don't get re-infilled with the Holy Spirit the whole time. Why? Because the Holy Spirit's a person. He's not, you know, understand what I'm saying? It's like, it's the most ridiculous thing that is taught. Either you have the Holy Spirit or you don't have the Spirit. It's bottom line. He doesn't move in and out. God's not fickle. You know, God doesn't come and then he moves in and then he sort of, you know, can you imagine where he sort of like leaves, you know, sort of the midst, and there's a little bit of him that stays behind, and then he suddenly moves back again, and then a little bit moves behind. Can you imagine if we had to be like that? We people, I mean, the Holy Spirit is God. He is a person. Okay, he's there or he's not. And so we receive the Holy Spirit. Then it's about surrendering and living in the Spirit. Now it says, led by the Spirit. It speaks about life in the Spirit. It speaks about all this kind of thing. The Spirit moves in and stays. And so we fellowship with the Father and Jesus through the Spirit within us. And it's continual. It's an abiding presence. And that's where the guys miss it. So what ends up happening is this pursuit of the Spirit, running after the Holy Spirit, so to speak. I mean, think how ridiculous that is. So, okay, you'll receive the Holy Spirit. And then you're going to have to chase him. And so people spend endless hours waiting, praying, when they've already received the Holy Spirit, because what are they looking for? They're looking for some, you know, feeling, some thing that filled, you know, go to the meetings and be filled all the time and that. And so people surrender to that and they fall down and all these things happen. No, you don't see that in the Bible. They fill, they go out. Peter, guy at the gate, beautiful, begging. What does Peter say? Silver and gold I don't have, but what I have, I give you. In the name of Jesus, get up and walk. The disciples go out. People bring cloths. And they lay hands on the cloths, and they take the cloths, and they go and lay it on people, and they're healed. They walk along, their shadow, just their shadow, falls on people, and they're healed. And it says, as it says, by the hands of the apostles, God did many signs and wonders, confirming the word with signs following. Powerful. It's so different to what has been taught. It's not a chasing after. It is an abiding and walking in that constantly, 24/7. It means that as believers, at any point, we can close our eyes. Where is the Holy Spirit? In our spirit. We are the tabernacle, and we can fellowship with the Father. We can hear him. We can commune with him. Jesus said, the world will not see me, but you will see me, because I will be inside of you. And so with our spirit, we see him. With our spirit, we fellowship with him. In the spirit, we walk out. We are vessels of the anointing. Now the anointing does not come upon us. We carry that anointing within us, and it surfaces whenever it's needed. In the Old Testament, they didn't lay hands on people for healing. In the New Testament, we lay hands on people. Why? Because there's an importation of what is inside of us. We have the gifts of the Spirit that operate. Okay? And we don't operate in all nine. We operate in but what we have. So because we have the Holy Spirit doesn't mean we have all nine the gifts. It means the gifts is an importation. It's again something that we need. That's why it says earnestly desire spiritual gifts. Desire it. Paul says, I desire to come to you that I may impart spiritual gifts to you. He tells Timothy to stir up the gift which is in him through the laying on of hands. And so that's something that was lost. You know, it's just the reason why most churches do not have the gifts operating anymore is because of that specific teaching. So the assumption is made that we have all nine the gifts, but we don't. Which is the easiest gift to mimic? Prophecy. Think of it. Prophecy is the easiest gift to counterfeit. And so prophecy is deteriorated down to something that is ridiculous. You know, so it just depends which denomination you come from or whatever. But you know, there's this one where, you know, like where we came from, you know, sort of like this, thus says the Lord, you know, and in those days was a King James, old King James. But all they're doing is actually just quoting scripture. That's not real prophecy. Real prophecy is normal. Talking to people normal. You know, God showing me this and this and this. And then sharing, God showed me there's going to be a drought. God showed me that there's going to be a problem with the water, the drinking water, that's going to be contaminated and cause disease. God is showing me that the government's going to collapse. God is showing me that, like now with ISIS, what's happening? God showed me something in this week, still got to do a video on it, about this attack of Hamas, and he showed me a dragon with seven heads, and he said, this is the smallest head, the other six heads are going to attack, and Europe is going to be drawn into this whether they like it or not, and same as America, because the war is about to go onto the soil of America and some of the European countries. That's prophecy. You see what I'm saying? Prophecy can be personal, can be for somebody. I see you are going to be offered a job, and you going, it's going to come out of the blue, you know, whatever. I mean, the list is endless. God showed me that you're going to have a child next year, this time, whatever. Prophecy foretells what is going to happen, true prophecy. And it's not dramatic, and, you know, this thus saith the Lord, and whoa, and then go into this old King James, like the Holy Spirit only can only speak in old King James English. It's the dumbest thing ever. And so I think in a nutshell, the time's up, is a lot of churches and people have settled for a second rate thing of, you know, being with the Holy Spirit. They're looking for feelings, and it's not about feelings. The feelings follow. So yes, there's times where you pray with the presence of God, you know, where there's this awareness that comes of the Spirit, and that, but it's more yielding. And just quickly, where it speaks about be constantly filled with the Spirit, it says, do not get drunk of wine, but be filled with the Spirit. And so they said, you know, be being filled. You probably all heard that teaching, be being filled. Yeah, so you've got to constantly be filled. No, well, if you go and look at the word filled that was used in Acts, and the word that's used is not the same word. The one is actually means being intoxicated. It basically says, don't get drunk of wine. Don't get intoxicated in the sense of being influenced by wine, but be intoxicated, influenced by the Spirit. Okay, so let Spirit be the one that determines your actions and, you know, whatever. So it's not talking about filled, continuously be being filled. It's not in the Greek, okay? And so it's a abiding, a yielding, a surrender to the Spirit. And we have this incredible fellowship with the Father and with Jesus because of it. And we're empowered to be witnesses and to reach the world. The harvest field is ready. The harvest is big, but the workers are few. Pray the Lord of the harvest that he will send workers.